Okay. Okay, we invite you to stand as you're able. Let's join together in our opening songs this morning. Follow your psalm sheet or the screen over here. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Sovereign Lord has given me an instructed tongue to know the word that sustains the weary. He wakens me morning by morning, wakens my ear to listen like one being taught. The Sovereign Lord has opened my ears. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. Last thing I need is to be of you. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, I hear your voice. Listen for the word of God. Amen. I invite you to turn to your neighbors now. Say hello to one another. Let's pass the peace of Christ.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you. I'm going to invite the ushers forward for our morning offering, please. God, we thank you for your grace and your goodness. We thank you for the bird song and the sunshine and the beautiful breeze. We thank you when the rain comes and when the night comes. God, we pray that you would give us glad and generous hearts to see you pouring out goodness again and again and again and again. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see. We ask that you would bless and accept and multiply this offering, that through it many may know you and many may know your help. We ask this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Join me in singing Make Us One. Let's sing it all together.
Make us one, Lord. Make us one.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit. Make us one.
Let your love.
Let your
today we continue our sermon series. It's called How to Love Your Enemy. And I invite you to take the Bible you brought with you. Maybe you've got one on your phone or your tablet. There are also Bibles near you. Those red books are Bibles. We're going to be in two scripture passages today. We are going to be in James chapter 1. So if you are using a paper Bible, that's going to be way towards the back. And we are going to be in John chapter 8. John chapter 8 is about three quarters of the way through if you're using a paper Bible with all the other Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are always about three quarters of the way through. Psalms are right in the middle, which is kind of fun. And so three quarters of the way through, you will find John. We are going to be in James chapter 1 first. This particular sermon series is based on a scripture from Matthew chapter 5, from the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus says this. Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven." And so, as followers of Christ, we hear this, and we ask, how do I do this, right? How do I do this? How do I foster peace and truth, especially when I find myself in situations where there is just evil going on, there's controversy going on, there is division, there's conflict, all of that. How do I do this? And so there are five spiritual practices that we've been talking about during this sermon series. And the way to remember them is that they're like attached to like body parts. I need tricks to remember things. The first is to have the mind of Christ. And so we mind, touch, you know, head, like head and shoulders, knees and toes, right? It's one of our favorite songs of our two-year-old granddaughter. So cultivating the mind of Christ, see people as people, you know, mind of Christ, see people as people, listen deeply, so ears, cultivate a heart of peace, and then do good. And so those are hands, right? So mind of Christ, see people as people, listen deeply, heart of peace, do good, right? And so all of these things are what we can do, things that we can practice, things that we can grow in knowing how to do, grow in this kind of a skill set for it. We can work on ourselves in this kind of situation and environments that we find ourselves in. We cannot control others, right? Can't control others. We're glad. That's good. We should not control others. God is not a puppet master. God does not control us. We don't control others. That's all good. So today we are going to talk about listening deeply. And the important reminder is that none of these practices, mind, eyes, ears, heart, hands, none of these practices say that it is okay for you to remain in a situation that is abusive or dangerous. That is not okay. And so if you find yourselves in a situation that is abusive or dangerous, we are here to help you. We are here to help you, okay? All right, James chapter 1, beginning at verse 19. James chapter 1, beginning at verse 19. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. For your anger does not produce God's righteousness. You know? Right relationship with God, right relationship with others, right relationship with ourselves. You know, this whole idea of healthy and unhealthy anger, that's a sermon for another day. So, you must understand this. So, it's super important, right? So, who must understand this, right? And it says, let everyone. So, this is something we all need to know. It's super important. Everybody needs to know how to listen deeply. Listen deeply. So let's do some scenarios. Scenario number one. We're greeting somebody and we just go into automatic pilot, right? Hello, good morning, how are you? And our ears turn off. We're not really listening to the person respond. We're not really making a connection with the person that we're talking to. We're just going through the greeting ritual. Check, I said hello to this person. Check, I said hello to that person. So, but we, as followers of Christ, we really want to connect. We believe everybody is made in the image of God. We're made in the image of God. We're not robots. We're not, you know, just mechanically doing things. We are genuinely interested in others, and we are genuinely interested in making a real connection. Steve Harper, who is a retired Methodist pastor and a retired seminary professor, he said this: when we stop listening, we stop relating. When we stop listening, we cease learning. When we stop listening, we lose perspective. When we stop listening, we define reality solely on our terms. And so this deep listening is critical, you know? You must understand this. Be quick to listen, slow to speak. Okay, how many ears do we have?
Two.
How many mouths do we have? One. Right? Right. So, two ears, one mouth. So our bodies remind us about kind of the perspective we should have on prioritizing listening and thinking before we speak. Right? Two ears, one mouth. So, deep listening, what deep listening does is it creates space for understanding. And this idea of creating space for understanding is great for our relationships with the folks we know and love and trust. And it is super important for our relationships with those that are harder to love, for folks we disagree with. So we're trying to build understanding. We're trying to say, why? Why would this person do this? Why would this person say this? Okay, so let's think for a minute about different kinds of conversations. In order to talk about different kinds of conversations, let's talk about fun things we like to do in the water. Okay, so what fun things do you like to do with the water?
Splash,
lovely. What else do you like to do? What, say it again?
Float.
Lovely. How nice is that? Okay. Float. Anybody else? Swim. Great. Ski. Ski on the water. Lovely. Did you say something, Tom?
Dive.
Sure. That could be fun.
Cannonballs.
Cannonballs. Oh. That's so funny. Maybe you like to kayak or ride in a boat, fishing, right? Okay, so let's think about swimming for a minute. Okay, swimming and snorkeling and diving. Let's think about those, and we're going to think about those in relationship to conversations. Okay, so Roz just got it. Okay, so we're swimming, right? And when we're swimming on top of the water. Okay. So, have you ever been in a conversation that just kind of stays on the surface level, right? It just stays up here. And it's okay to have conversations like that. There's nothing wrong with conversations like that. Okay, but if we're snorkeling, right? If we're snorkeling, then we can go down for a little bit, you know? We can go down and look at some things, but we have to come back up for air, right? We go down for a little bit, and we come back up for air. So maybe you've been in a conversation like that. You're having a kind of a swimming conversation. All of a sudden, it turns to snorkeling, and you go down to something deeper, right? Something maybe more vulnerable, more intimate, you know, that kind of thing. And then it pops back up. Ooh, how about those bucks? You know, then it might go down again, deeper, maybe for a little bit, and then boop, it pops back up, right? So that's another kind of conversation, this down and up, down and up. Okay, in order to go down under the water and stay down under the water, we need some skills. We need some training. We need some equipping. If you're going to be a scuba diver, you're licensed, right? It's riskier to go down there and stay down there. But have anybody in here scuba? Anybody? Yeah, we've got some scuba divers in the room. I have heard that it is spectacular. There is nothing like scuba diving. And so what would it be like to create an environment where we can have where people feel so safe that they can go down to these deeper levels of the why behind what they're saying and the why behind what they're doing? They can go down these deeper levels and stay there a bit so that we can build some understanding with one another. Okay? So this is the deep listening that helps us love our enemy well. So what we want to do is we want to look below the surface. What is really, really going on here? Let's talk about another conversation. Have you ever had a conversation where the person says something and they're explaining and all of that, and all of a sudden your ears turn off because you're thinking about how you're going to respond? Right? These are the conversations that we're taught to have. We're taught to have conversations that are kind of like tennis matches. Right? And so, you know, the first person says, oh, I want to talk about this, and they hit the ball to you, and you're like, oh, and that reminds me of this, and you hit the ball back, and they said, oh, and this reminds me of this, and, you know, it could be a great conversation. You know, you're enjoying yourself, you're hitting the ball back and forth, it's all going well. And, but if the conversation turns heated, all of a sudden you're like facing a grand champion tennis player, and the ball's coming at you at some crazy speed, and it's like, oh my goodness, it's like, and I'm gonna serve again, and you know, I mean, right? And so if we're just thinking how we're gonna respond, we start getting reactionary, like, oh, I've gotta respond quickly because this stuff is coming so fast. And really what we can do is we can slow things down, and we can take in what's being said. We can even let the balls go by. We're just kind of watching what's going on. And we can take it in, and rather than react, we can respond. We can respond to what's going on. And these things, this idea of listening deeply and getting below the surface and responding rather than reacting, these things are all the things that Jesus does in the passage we're going to read in John 8 today. This is a moment where we see Jesus making peace by listening deeply. So, John chapter 8, beginning at verse 2. Early in the morning, Jesus came again to the temple. Everybody there? We got it? I hear pages turning. Okay. Early in the morning, Jesus came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and began to teach them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery, and making her stand before all of them, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the very act of committing adultery." My question is, where's the guy? Right? Okay, moving on. Now, in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. What do you say? They said this to test Jesus so that they might have some charge to bring against him. Okay, we're seeing deeper. We're at scuba level with this little comment. There's some stuff going on below the surface. Jesus does not react. Notice what he does. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. When they kept on questioning him, there's more tennis balls coming, right? Grand slam. There. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." He responds. And once again, he bent down and wrote on the ground. What did he write on the ground? We don't know. People get their doctorates deciding what Jesus wrote on the ground. We don't know. I want to see it on the Jumbotron in heaven. You know? What'd you write on the ground? You know. Verse 9, when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the elders, folks who had walked with God the longest, you know. Maybe they were more self-aware. Maybe the message was getting to them a little quicker than the others. When they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the elders, and Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus straightened up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, sir." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go your way, and from now on, do not sin again." And instead of the situation ending with Jesus being trapped, instead of the situation ending with the woman dying, the situation ends with greater understanding, greater peace, greater hope, greater safety, greater trust, greater belonging, all of these things. That is what peacemaking is. Peter Senge says this: to listen fully means to pay close attention to what is being said beneath the words. You listen not only to the music, but to the essence of the person speaking. You listen not only to what someone knows, but who they are. Ears operate at the speed of sound, which is far slower than the speed of light that the eye takes in. How will you foster peace and truth this coming week? By listening deeply. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for ears to hear. We thank you for your example. We thank you for these practices. And we pray that you would send the Holy Spirit that we may grow in truth and in grace, that we may grow in self-awareness, that you would fill us with courage so we may join you in making peace. Sharon, would you come and continue to pray for us?
The prayer today is written by Jack Knox, pastor of Salem Mennonite Church in Oregon. Gracious Lord, we dream of a world free of poverty and oppression, and we yearn for a world free of vengeance and violence, and we pray for your peace. When our hearts ache for the victims of war and oppression, help us to remember that you healed people simply by touching them. Give us faith in our ability to comfort and heal bodies and minds and spirits that have been broken by violence. When the injustice of this world seems too much for us to handle, help us to remember that you fed 5,000 people with only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Give us hope that what we have to offer will turn out to be enough too. When fear of the power and opinions of others tempts us not to speak up for the least among us, help us to remember that you dared to turn over the tables of money changers. Give us the courage to risk following you without counting the cost. When we feel ourselves filled with anger at those who are violent and oppressive, help us remember that you prayed for those who killed you. Give us compassion for our enemies, too. When we tell ourselves that we have given all we can to bring peace to this world, help us to remember your sacrifice. Give us the miracle of losing a little more of ourselves in serving you and our neighbors. Walk with us, Lord, as we answer your call to be peacemakers. Increase our compassion, our generosity, and our hospitality for the least of your children. Give us the courage, the patience, the serenity, the self-honesty, and the gentleness of spirit that are needed in a world filled with turmoil and terror. I invite your own prayers. Gracious Lord, help us to live the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Announcements. Announcements for today. Our quarterly leadership council meeting will be held Tuesday, May 7th at 6:30 in the fellowship hall. The meeting will include important reports and discussions. It's an open meeting and all are welcome. On Sunday mornings, we have two adult small groups who are welcoming new members. One is the Friendship Class Bible Study that meets in room 109. And then there's the Journey in Spirituality Discussion Group that meets in room 116. If you're interested in starting a small group on Sundays or another day of the week, please contact Pastor Lisa or Gary Eves, Chair of the Vision Team. The General Conference of the United Methodist Church will begin meeting on Tuesday. Thank you for praying for this important discussion making gathering. More information on the General Conference and a prayer guide can be found in the back of the sanctuary.
Thank you, Sharon. We invite you to stand now as you're able for our closing song, Speak, O Lord.
Teach us, Lord, full of obedience.
Beloved of God, what is our mission? Building community rooted in God's love, inviting all to grow in Christ, engaging with service and compassion. Friends, we hope that you will stick around for a while. We hope that you will greet one another and have a great conversation with one another, and receive this blessing. Go now in peace. Go to love. Go to serve. Go to listen. Go with the blessing and power of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I invite you to join with us in our closing chorus. Go now in peace. Go.